Okay, so there's been a few variations of this Grand Plaza Hecarim ephemeral deck going around. This build is different than a lot of the other ones out there. It's a little bit different than the one that's on my website, and it's been different than what the ones some of the other streamers have been playing. One thing that it's got here, I titled this Pesky Ephemerals. It's playing Pesky Spectre, and this is a card that I've been impressed with in other games that we've played with it. It being, when you're attacking on odds, being able to play Plaza and then play Pesky Spectre as a 2-2 to immediately attack has been sweet. It allowing you to have something to triggers dies for free for things like Kalista and Prankster has been good. It being another zero mana ephemeral to play out with Hecarim or bring back your Shark Chariots on a key turn has been good. One way this build differs from the build that's up on my website is this build is leveraging Stalking Shadows, where we have a few less combat tricks, so we can play this to hit some of our units that we want a little bit more consistently. This build is notably not playing Lucian, which feels like it could be a mistake. I think there's a good chance Lucian's a little bit better than Kalista. For those that are new to the channel, this is a viewer submission, so we're going to start here, and we'll probably make changes as we go after playing a few games, so let's dive on in and see how it goes. Yes, Pesky Spectre is also a Nightfall enabler for the Evershade Stalker. It's worth noting as well. Jeans, good morning and welcome to the channel. Our unit counts at 27. Din, we have 21 hits for Stalking Shadows plus 6 champions. Barfy seems kind of mediocre. Honestly, I think I should put just Mulligan for Plaza, and these cards seem super exciting. Good morning, Earl. Welcome to the channel. Soul Shepherd down to start. If I kill you, I don't fart you. I don't think I really want to trade this for the 2-1 plus a Gohard. I'll trade it for the 2-2 plus a Gohard. I think this is fine. I get to play Kalista down here for the turn, and then if they kill this, she collects her first thing here. Shark Chariot plus Evershade Stalker here could get our Kalista level this turn, which is nice.
Never lost a fair game or played one. Dead in their tracks.
And here's kind of that tough squeeze with these ephemeral decks, right? I think I need to bank mana for this for now. We're kind of on the back foot. We're gonna have a good attack here, and we're nowhere near killing them. Second of these. Will I play that archetype? Yeah, we actually have a deep variation coming up here. I think we're going to get to it today if the viewer count stays strong. We played traditional SI deep fairly recently. You can find it up on my archives channel. We we play that here? That's true, too. A lot of the decks we play here are viewer submissions, so if you want to see something specific, you're always welcome to add it to the queue for a small donation. They do have Vengeance mana available here. Definitely on the back foot here to start. Burkbeast. Burkbeast is a card that the build that's on our site is notably staying away from. And seeing them get picked off by Gohards is a good reason for that, I think. Okay-ish attack here. Getting to whittle down their board is nice. Their Twisted Fate's getting pretty close to leveling at this point. Yeah, they have a Glimpse to put this to 5, so another Glimpse or a Salvage, and they're gonna have this flipped over. I'm not convinced that this card is playable. With our Ephemerals and things like Sharks, we frequently have a lot of our board space taken up, and it feels like we don't really have board space to leverage this consistently. Don't know much, do ya? I don't know, I've always been underwhelmed by Darkwater Scourge and decks that don't involve Deathmark or the Ephemeral card.
Now this game's heating up. Blue as the Serpentine.
Yeah, they get to kill Ikaram here. So far, not a good start for the changes that this build has versus the other one that we played. So let's talk about that. It feels weird seeing a 37 SI card deck without any Allegiance. Are there other non-SI cards you think I should be playing? Or is there an Allegiance card that you think is valuable? Why do you think Wraithcaller is good in this deck? Would be my question to you. There we go. Maybe with this draw, we're supposed to hold the Chariot.
By my honor, you must die.
I really haven't been impressed with single combat in this archetype. I think it's worse than combat tricks a lot of the time. The build I've played a bit of is playing Sharp Sight as a trick. Yeah, I think Lucian is, yeah, this is like super single combat. I agree with that. I don't even know if that's true. I think in a lot of these decks, single combat just tends to be pretty redundant alongside Grand Plaza. We're supposed to crack this open and get the ooey gooey nugget out of its center. Beowulf and Rotting, thanks for the follows. Good morning. Sure.
I have equal.
One of the things I'd like to point out to people in chat who keep recommending lots of random cards is people in chat just keep telling me what cards are good in my deck. You're suggesting cards. You're saying, well, that card's good with what you're doing, Jeff. And the really important part that you're missing in those conversations is, what is it better than? Do you have Glimpse of Revenge from Love? Like, no, I don't think so. I think we just do this and kill her here. Alright, I'm gonna... Yeah, I probably... Yeah, this, What are the words I'm searching for? This deck has a lot of the same similar ideas to the build that we had played previously that felt good, but it's a number of cards different, and I think we're just gonna play... We're just gonna play some Lucian Hecarim for the rest of this set. I think what this build is doing is just a little bit more cohesive. Lucian as a pseudo combo enabler is just stronger. Things like Haunted Relic are good. Still playing Pesky Spectre. This card was good last time we played it, and Butcher, but I think the core of what this deck is doing is just a little bit more powerful. Things like Remembrance and stuff. So I'm gonna play this for the rest of the set. Yeah, I agree. The other deck had a lot of really low card quality cards in it. Bark Beast is like super mediocre. Things like an 0-3 for 3. That original submission, when I got it, didn't actually have Grand Plaza in it, which was a big miss, and I tried to just add that in and see if the other details could be okay, but they're really just not as good. This hand's kind of absurd, huh? We play this on 2, we do this on 3.
Push back the darkness.
But playing Endure Aggro here, it looks like. No, Hecarim is pretty essential to this deck's game plan. It's a deck that's basically built around this card. Okay, so that's the first thing that's died. So that means when we do this, we're gonna get to rally this turn. These are gonna bring back Shark Chariot.
Come on, boys. Bring in the heat.
I'm okay trading this for a Bark Beast. So these three level Lucian. He hits for 8, Shark Chariot triggers his rally. And just like, I'm glad that we could immediately jump into a game and show the power of Lucian versus Kalista. And like, Hecarim's gonna level on his first attack here, because the Shark Chariot's gonna come back with him. Yeah, yeah, the eye is really well done. For sure. Lucian has guns, Kalista has spear, you do the math. Yeah, this is the build that's card for card up on my website. This is my preferred build of Plaza Ephemerals. I like the low to the ground nature of this build, the Ravenous Butcher. A lot of the builds I've seen other people playing aren't playing the Ravenous Butcher slash I'm blanking on his name, the one drop or the two drop. Oh, I should put this one up on my Mobalytics page. Keeper. Yeah, they're not playing Cursed Keeper. And I've really liked Cursed Keeper in this build. Cursed Keeper feels like it gives you something meaningful to do when you don't draw Grand Plaza.
Nothing like the stink of blood and sweat.
Yeah, big agree with that. Yeah, Shark Reviving comes back with Grand Plaza. It'll get the bonus. It notably will not get to challenge something, but it will get the +1/+1.
Don't get in my way.
Actually, you know what? Playing this might be wrong, because if I draw the 2-mana Ephemeral spell, I can't play it now with Plaza. Is Grizzled Ranger too slow for this deck? I just think Grizzled Ranger is not a card that's very good if you don't have Plaza out. It just feels mediocre, and I'd rather focus on playing more cards that are good more often. I think I'm just passing here and planning to glimpse this when they go hard me. If they don't go hard me, I only burn 1 mana here. I think this is a better play. I really am not a fan of Bark Beast Precipic. I'm also not a huge fan of Relentless Pursuit.
Got a surprise for
him. Yeah, card's very narrow. And we're playing Radiant Guardian, that's plenty of respect for burn. We've got Remembrance as well. Remembrance is another card a lot of people, I haven't seen other people playing, but like, this card's been very good. You frequently get to play it for free like this. This turn is likely going to be a free Remembrance. This is another card that allows you to have these kind of crazy nuts draws when you don't have Plaza in play. And I really feel like that's the direction you should build this archetype in. This deck is always good when you have Plaza, but maximizing how good your deck is when you don't have Plaza is what you need to be doing.
Never lost a fair game. Or played one.
Okay, so we're gonna sharp sight this Ephemeral here, so that way I can bring Shark back. Because this is about to deal 2 damage to everything. I think I do this for board control purposes.
Something for all.
Pick a card ing before this dies is interesting. Odin. One Radiant Guardian, please. Rats. They could just be trying to pack next turn, that's true. Yeah, I'm aware, Ruin. Hey, look, the present we give them.
Keep up.
They've only played one pack so far, right? Yeah, it's only their second. They need to have, need to have two more here to tell us to pack the bags. Okay, so we're gonna get to open attacks here. They could be running their own pesky specters. That's true. That is technically something they could be doing. Not quite leveled yet. Probably gonna be too slow. Opening on tax here is important. Rather than playing this out. Oh, the box. That's cute.
No.
I fight for the fallen.
So we are dead to pack here. We are unfortunately at exactly five. Oh, you know what? I should have played this because it dilutes their deck two cards, technically, right? Probably wouldn't matter, but strictly optimal to do this. I'm not playing single combat random digit.
Be nothing left when I'm done.
Swing low, shark chariot, come along to carry me home. Well. Atrocity is not a card that's usually played that archetype, right? That seems hella greedy. Fortunate to dodge pack your bags. Unfortunate to die exactly these two Atrocity. Sometimes they just want it for you. Allery, thanks for the follow. Good morning. Pretty easy full mulligan here. Hands not. You're basically mulliganing looking for Plaza or aggressive Lucian hands with this deck. Either of those two things are fine. Hi, Grid and Peps. Good morning. In my experience playing this more aggressively slanted variation of this archetype, I think that on average, single combat tends to be worse than playing the pump spell that we're playing, the +2/+2, because being able to push damage with our utility card is most valuable. Sharpsight, I think it tends to be better on average. Like I said, one of the things this build is trying to do, I'm trying to maximize how good our deck can be when we don't draw this card specifically. And having a more proactive game plan with things like Sharp Slates, as opposed to being more reactive with something like single combat, is better, I think. You could technically play Kalista, but the champ... This is... While there are some decks in Runeterra where you can substitute things for other champions in the deck, this really isn't one of them. I think I would recommend playing something else until you have the last two champions, rather than substituting things in here. Lucian and Hecarim are very key to what this deck is looking to do. Goddor, good morning and welcome. Your deck will be much... I think there are plenty of decks where you can swap out champions. It's not a big deal. This deck is not one of them. Your deck will be significantly worse without Lucian and Hecarim. Like I mentioned, one of the two things you're mulliganing for early in this deck is either a fast Lucian hand or Plaza, and having fewer Lucians to mulligan for that's a pretty big deal. Toto M, thanks for the follow. Good morning. Merry Christmas and all that jazz to everybody out there. Happy holidays. Happy Saturday, if you're not into all that other sort of stuff. For dropping in. If you're new to the channel, like all the wonderful folks that have followed this morning, I do Runeterra stuff full-time here. I've been doing Runeterra full-time since the beginning of October. Before that, I streamed Magic the Gathering and other various card games here as a full-time gig on Twitch, but Runeterra is definitely the best card game out there, I think, in 2020, and it's the one that I spend my time on now. I'm here 5 to 6 days a week doing Runeterra stuff. Usually play 3 or 4 different constructed decks every single day.
I am more myself than ever.
How do we feel about playing out Shark Chariot expecting Hecarim to happen next turn? They've invoked... The odds of them having Meteor off of this are pretty low. My opponent could have enough mana to play the double Obliterate next turn, depending on what they do, though. Okay, so that's their Traveler Invoke. Okay, so we're definitely playing Hecarim next turn then, right? You got it. There could be merit to holding up Glimpse here, but Shark Chariot's gonna give me an extra big attack, so I think I wanna just try and get that in. Born in Yoto. Thanks for the follow. Yes, yeah, the fact that we got the Hush out of them to deny us that 4-3 means that they don't have a Hush potentially for Hecarim this turn before he attacks, which is good. Sad Panda. That's fine. Gotta work our way through it. Less likely doesn't mean 0%. Sharp Slate's pretty good there. Huh. Second Lucian means that this is a rally. That's lethal, right? Because this is going to bring two things plus a shark back. I don't think Harrowing solves any problems that this deck has. Man, the third Hush will get you every time. Oh, I could have killed this. This had Challenger. Yeah, you're right. I missed killing that with Lucian. You are correct. I think it's right to just open here. Damn it, Precipic! Turns out missing this probably didn't matter. Weird. And again, Judgment's just one of those cards that feels bad, but you can't play around it. You have to attack. They don't play a lot of copies of them. When they have it, it sucks, you know? This is definitely a low roll game for us, high roll game for the opponent. Triple hush into the Judgment to stay alive. Not even just mono answers, but exactly the right answers, exactly the right points. I mean, Judgment's just one of those 2 or 10 cards, right? It's a card that when it's good, it's unbeatable, and when it's bad, it's unplayable, and it just rots in your hand and you die. Yeah, we're not dead either, right? Like, we've got another Hecarim here. I've got a Glimpse to gas back up with. Like, their Judgment there, like, kept them alive, but it hasn't won them the game yet. Hey, Ice, thanks for the follow. Good morning. Almost afternoon here in the cornfields. The Skies Descend worth playing around? No. Also, Skies Descend currently costs them 11 mana, so they don't have that available. Avenge me. And if, like, your opponent's on Skies Descend and... If our opponent's on Skies Descend and Judgment, they just want it way more than us, and that's fine, they can have it. Swole Teemo! Let me tell you, Swole Teemo, if you weren't here last night, Santa stopped by and played Teemo Mushrooms on stream. It was a good time. Definitely check out that highlight if you weren't here yesterday. Good morning, Ludo. I think I'm playing Shark Chariot, just have a full board of attackers next turn. This does mean if they have single combat, I can't hold up Glimpse here, but if they have single combat for this, I'm probably in trouble anyways, so. This is definitely the way this game has gone so far. We might still win on the back of this Haunted Relic here. Like, again, like, our opponent has had every answer possible at every moment and during this game, and, like, we're still just in it to win it. Really, I feel like this really showcases some of the power of the deck that we're playing, right? Like, I feel like every possible opportunity our opponent has had to blow us out, they've blown us out, and, like, we still have a lethal attack here. We beat Star Shaping, we beat single piece of removal, we're gonna get completely hosed by Second Judgment, but again, there's nothing we can do about that. We're definitely attacking in. That's not good enough. They need a second one. They need this plus a single combat or concerted strike would get them here. Yeah, definitely want to cash some cards in here. I don't think I want to play this out. I only need one blocker to not be dead on board, and I want to have Ephemerals rolled up to bring my sharks back next turn. Yeah, again, just like, think about what's happened this game. All of the answers my opponents had. We've drawn three plazas in the top half of our deck, and like, we're still in a position to swing for lethal next turn again. That's gonna do it, right? Because that gives these overwhelm. Yeah, and again, just like, at every possible moment, our opponent having the right thing eventually caught up to us, but we stayed in that much longer than I was expecting to. And again, like, those are the types of losses you need to disconnect. You need to be able to disconnect from, like, what's the best way for it? That type of loss is why people putting their record with their deck in their stream title or their overlay or whatever, I think it's pretty silly and pointless. The sample sizes that we're going to have on any given stream are so incredibly small that they don't outweigh the details of games like that, right? Like, the nuance and the details of, like, what actually happens in the games that you played is so much more important than what your actual record is. Because, like, if you go 1-3 and most of your games look like that last one, it's like, well, is that record really meaningful? Or in the inverse, if you're, like, 4-0 with the deck, but your opponents have made mistakes or you've run extra hot, your win streak also isn't super meaningful. Like, that not being relevant swings hard in both directions. CS, thanks for the follow. For people that are new to the channel and you don't know much about myself, before I started streaming full-time a few years back, I have a master's degree in mathematics. I spent some time working as a systems analyst for a Fortune 50 company after grad school for a little bit, so I'm very analytically minded, good at problem solving. Focusing on data-driven decisions is one of my strengths when it comes to playing games. Definitely just taking the hit for four here, right? Gonna have a pretty good turn next turn. Well, we were already having a good turn, and then we drew Haunted Relic, so... We have guess. Berkmo Bread, thanks for the follow. Welcome to the channel. Clip that for LinkedIn. If I do ever end up going back to a traditional job after making content, I think some of the interviews should be fun. What was this part of your work history? Please explain. Well, you see, I think we're Haunted Relicing here. It's always really easy to explain my job to new people when I meet them out in the world. And it's very simple. Usually I just say that I stream live on the internet, taking money from strangers that I've never met to perform tasks that they request of me. And my audience is largely men ages 25 to 34. And there's definitely no way that could be confused for anything other than what it actually is. This is actually really good. It denies me the death trigger here, which means that Lucian doesn't get to level up before hitting them, which is huge. So they take a lot less damage here. That's actually a really big swing. I didn't kill the barrel because I wanted to push as much damage as possible there. And then I got punished for doing so. For attempting to do so. It's not my fault that I can see the future. I mean, isn't it Precipic? Isn't it your fault? Welcome back. Through the coral. It's funny, I remember when I was traveling to play Magic full-time, Christy told me she always used to tell her coworkers that I just played poker, because explaining what Magic the Gathering was too deep of a rabbit hole for her to get into. I think we play both of these out, and then we Hecarim into attacks next turn. Opponent notably only on 8 mana here, so Ruination isn't a concern this turn. They could have Vengeance to kill this, but I still have okay-ish attacks. I think Twitch is almost easy. I think Twitch is easier to explain to other people. Because even if they've never heard of Twitch as a platform, you can just describe it as YouTube, and most people are familiar with YouTube. You have to get, like, down to my grandparents for them to not know what YouTube is as a reference. It could honestly be right to play this for 1/2/2 to hook the Twisted Fate. What was it? Having traveled to play a bunch of Magic, competitive Magic players and, like, people that play poker professionally, there's a lot of overlap there, so, like, I know a number of professional poker players. And one of my buddies that played poker professionally along with Magic stuff, he always described playing poker full-time as the modern-day version of running off to join the circus. So, Fallen Majesty, what you're doing there is you're assuming I took the established deck and cut a card from it, whereas this deck was started from a blank slate and is different. One of the things players in all card games fail to do too frequently is one big streamer or personality or tournament player builds a deck, and then people get lazy and they stop innovating and they stop trying things. And they just say, whatever Mogwai played or whatever BBG played or whatever Swim played, that's the build. And you can't deviate from the build because popular figure X built deck like X. And again, I think this build I prefer to those established builds that have been popular because of streamers, because the more aggressive slant in this deck gives you better draws when you don't have Plaza. And you're correct that going into the long game, this deck is worse in a long game without something like Rekindler than the Rekindler builds are. But that's not my goal. My goal is to kill my opponent rather than grind out a long game. In my experience playing with, playing against, and watching other people play those Rekindler builds, those builds look atrocious every time they don't have Grand Plaza in play. They look, like, unplayably bad. What are we doing here? Is it crazy to play Haunted Relic? I feel like it is. It would level Lucian. Leveling Lucian's kind of appealing. having these for next turn with Hecarim's kind of appealing, though. I'm gonna pass and see what they do. I got you, Cassius. I don't think comparing TCGs to poker is very apt. In fact, I think that comparison's very bad. I think poker and TCGs overlap some of the same skills, but in terms of the types of gameplay that they produce, poker, you're playing yourself against a group of people, whereas competitive card games are one-to-one, and the dynamics of the games that you play are far more different than just you're building a deck versus using a deck of cards. So I actually think the TCGs play like poker is a very bad comparison. It shows a lack of depth of understanding of what you're doing inside of those games. Hey, back it up, champ. Like a fish in water. I think there's overlap in the types of people that enjoy those games, and that's fine to talk about. We just open attacks here. This levels Lucy and it gives me an attack token. This is kind of crappy against Vengeance. Like, they very likely have packed the bags is the problem here. More of these decks have been playing Vile Feast. Warping Whale also kills Lucian. Stay a while. The turn I didn't hook the keg early on was definitely a mistake that caught up and bit us. The fact that they got to kill my Lucian early was a mistake that snowballed. If I'd have leveled Lucian, this game would be much easier. So, Fallen Majesty, so what you're doing there is something that I find is very common in card games, and this is not specific to Runeterra. You're saying, my aggro deck is down on cards, so I need to play a card that catches me up on cards. In my opinion, that's the wrong approach. The solution to your aggro deck being down on cards isn't jam a bunch of expensive card advantage into your aggro deck, it's kill them faster. Not every deck is supposed to draw a bunch of cards and go super long. And if you want to draw a bunch of cards and go super long, there's a number of decks in Runeterra, such as this opponent's archetype, which is very good at doing explicitly that. But in general, I think players too often go, this game got drug out and I need card advantage, when in reality, the aggressive deck should just be looking to end the game sooner. Stratos, thanks for the follow. Good morning.
Let's do this.
Like, in this game is actually a good example of something like that, right? Like, this is a game where this game has gone long. And I think a less experienced player would look at this game and conclude, Jeff, you just couldn't keep up as the game went long, and your deck needs things like Rekindle to get back into games like this. When in my opinion, the correct takeaway at looking at how this game played out was, Jeff, you should have prioritized killing that keg on one of the earlier turns, so that way they couldn't have killed your Lucian, you would have leveled him, and then you would have beat down and won this game before it got to this point. And that's one of the things that's tough about all card games, is that it's very difficult to evaluate what are you supposed to do, or where did your mistake happen, right? The real players can play to Riot about Gohard being OP. Oh, Gohard. Yeah, we did. The Vlad Skargrounds deck is a good comparison. We talked about something very similar. Well, and especially games like Runeterra, and this is one of the reasons why I love Runeterra as a game, is Runeterra has more player agency, more in-game decisions than any other card game I've ever played. And when you're making so many decisions in a game like Runeterra, it can often be hard to pin down where exactly did you go wrong? Which decision did you make that was the decision that put you behind and lost you the game? And thinking back to this game, the play that put me behind in this game and is likely going to mean that I lose it happened on turn 2 or 3, right? And this is now turn 11, but the mistake that I made happened a long time prior. And being able to have the insight to look back and go, well, I lost this game on turn 11, but my mistake was on turn 3 and that snowballed. So I don't need cards that help me on turn 11. I need to play better and not make those mistakes on turn 2 to 3. Wait, are they really leaving Radiant Guardian alive? Sick. All right, maybe we have a shot. Them drawing 3 cards here, I think they should definitely kill Radiant Guardian here and deny me the life game.
Who says I don't share?
And yeah, having the same conversations, I often say streaming on Twitch is a lot like being a parent. You need to speak slowly and repeat yourself often. I'm gonna roll next game. Let's try and get one where we don't mess it up on turn 2 to 3. Our opponent's gonna take a lot more game actions here, but there's a good chance we lose this. I think we're experiencing a little garbage time there. The game is over, but we haven't lost yet. Scandamoose, thanks for the follow. Good morning. Seems good. I'm gonna mulligan the sharp sight, looking for another threat. Nice. Okay, so this is one of the starts I love in this deck. So we get to play this on their turn 2, and then our turn 3 will be Plaza into Butcher Pop the Cursed Keeper. Having watched a lot of BBG's content, I definitely agree with the idea that his builds tend to be biased towards making things more mid-range and grindy. Those are the types of decks that he excels at playing. And he tends to tune his decks for that. Well, we get a hit in for 3 here at least. Do I want to do this? I think I want to save this for a turn when I can pair it with Remembrance. This also brings back Shark down the line. I don't think the Undying really solves any problems that we have, DNR. The Undying is a very grindy card, and the goal of this deck that I'm currently playing is to be an aggressively slanted deck. No blocks. Go to 16. No attack. Deal. Thank you. a good draw. We'll get to kill this with this, play this, bring this back. And actually, we can play this pre-combat, right? We get to play this as well. I think something that players underestimate a lot of the time, especially in a game like Runeterra, where there's so many different decks you can play in this game, is I mentioned BBG seems like he always builds decks to be more controlling, and that's good if you enjoy that type of deck. In a game like Runeterra, where there's so many different competitive decks to be playing, building decks in a way that you enjoy playing them more will net you more wins. Games are something you should be playing for fun, and if you are enjoying yourself on average, you're probably going to win more often. I mean, to be fair, almost all the hits from Remembrance are good there, because they were all going to have Challenger. This was probably the best draw in my deck. Seem that good at this point, right? Like, I guess it's giving me +1/+1 next turn on a couple of things, but
stop bragging if you could back it up. Ooh, that's gotta hurt.
We just draw a bunch of cards here. They are Ezreal Swain. Yep. Yeah, getting to stop the level up here is so nice. Thanks for the follow. Welcome to the channel.
Destination in sight.
The chains, they never stop.
Forward!
Sounds dangerous. I'm in.
Just take this hit. Their Swain is actually not leveled yet. Yeah, we have Hearthstone Lethal on the open attack, so are we just supposed to take that? Probably, right? Attacking right away with this means it levels and no longer dies to, means it no longer dies to, Flock as well. They can technically not be dead here if they can kill these two. Grandpa Scoozy, good morning and welcome. Sometimes you can and should play around things is accurate. Thanks everybody for hanging out this morning, by the way. Pretty awesome to see almost 1,000 people in here for some Maroon Terra stuff. Had a bunch of new followers. Everybody had a wonderful Christmas / Friday yesterday. Morning, Ducky. This is kind of like, this is kind of one of the best cards in this matchup, right? Being able to kill our own thing so Fiora can't. Santa does stream Rune Terra on occasion. Make sure you check out that highlight. It's wonderful. I bear a message from... Oh, hey, what's that? No, that's an organic viewer count. We are the only... One of the only bigger folks on this morning. Any fun control decks to suggest? I have a website that has a number of decks of every archetype up there. You go to jeffhoagland.com and click Rune Terra decks. There's some buttons for every different kind. Hey, chat, is this good? Is this good? If so, why? Please explain. Nice Fiora. Gobble, gobble. O-Town, thanks for the follow. Welcome. Good morning. It is a combo as old as Rune Terra itself, but it's extra good with Plaza. Why didn't he kill Zoe? Because Zoe generates card advantage. The life gain thing lets them race us, and I'd rather they not be able to race us. Huh? I think I'm gonna open on Glimpse here. Well, that's sweet. Now we open on that, right? There you are. I didn't eat this because then my bench would overfill. Yeah, being able to look at what the leaderboard people are playing is sweet. I love Rune Terra's data accessibility is one of the many things that I love about the game. Riot knows they've created a good product, and they know they don't need to hide information. How much of the jargon you are using from Magic is part of all card games or Rune Terra, and how much is just you using what you're used to? I try and be even when I was streaming Magic, I generally speaking try to be as card game neutral as possible. There's a lot of terms that translate across all the different games pretty cleanly, I think. Honestly, it could be right to eat this pre-combat just to push damage. I think I like that. I think I just want to hit them for a bunch here. The butterfly is wonderful. Whee! This is my favorite. This is my favorite companion for sure. I think the one piece of magic jargon that doesn't really translate well to Runeterra that I need to try and figure out a cleaner way to say, I use the verbiage tapped out quite frequently in Runeterra still. This is the danger of trying to draw cards proactively here, but I have another one. Greeks and Emperor Black, thanks for the follows. Welcome to the channel. Good morning. Meme Big Boy and Mr. XO. Howdy, howdy. Welcome to Hoaglandia. Huh. You know what? I think we actually want to hook this one here. My ordering's kind of whatever here. I think hooking this one here is important because this means Zoe dies even if they have Hush or +2/+2, which is valuable. So it gets some damage marked on this, but it plays around their potential pump effects here. Guaranteeing the kill on her seems really good. Pale Cascade 2, yep. A lot of tricks they could have had there. Was that the best draw in our deck? Running a little bit hot here to make up for some of the bad beats earlier. Our cumulative variance is balancing itself back out, chat.
Look at this reality! Look how sparkly!
Look out, sparkly! Push back the darkness.
Can't block an elusive unit. The hell it can't, Runeterra. That's a lovely draw. Fresh soil. For people that are new to the channel and asking why the dinner message was deleted, I give my 12-month subscribers mod status on the channel, and getting asking for a timeout here is kind of a running channel joke. So if one of the mods asks for a timeout, it takes their mod sword away. And then when they come back, the other mods tend to be mean to them. They're big, big bullies.
They grow up so fast.
Burn away the shadow.
Stunning our ephemerals here to deny our shark is real, real good. So, Lucian will get to level at end of turn, but we won't get to rally this turn now. It's a good play on the opponent's part.
Strength in grace, beauty in the blade.
I actually think the Vlad Skargrouch deck is super reasonable. My highlight on my highlights YouTube channel today was Vlad Riven Skargrouch. I think that deck is super decent. A cat herder, thank you for the quarter of a year. I really appreciate the prime. Welcome back. Good morning. Tarek is your pick for worst champion in the game right now. Is that true? Yeah, I think with Grand Plaza, even cat's better than Tarek. I think I'd agree with that. That's an assessment I'd agree with.
Let them eat souls. On guard.
On guard. Can I get a timeout to demonstrate the point you just made? Of course, Raceland. Thank you for the 22 months. Welcome back. we're just passing here. I want to play this and have plenty of bench space next turn. Well, all right, for sure. change of plans. Speaking of Raceland and Caramon, if you're a fan of the Dragonlance book series, which I read those growing up as an adolescent as well, there is a Russian musical version that tells part of those stories, and it's on YouTube. So, like, if you're looking for something and don't mind watching something with subtitles, it's a riot. It's really well done. I think we're playing this, overrating this, and just trying to push a bunch of damage this turn. I guess that's not great. Let's see what they do here. Some people aren't fans of watching subtitle content. That's fine. It's super, super personal preference type thing. All right. Now we're overwriting. Oh, wow. That gets rid of their ephemeral status, too. It's annoying. I can attack with this. Yeah, I think attacking here is more important than keeping the bigger thing long term. Yeah. Yeah. For subtitled stuff, you have to be actively watching. You can't just background it. Lore Karma, thanks for the follow. I'm hoping this isn't a trick here. They silenced both of these. If we get to kill Fiora here, we're in a pretty good spot. I think we're in an okay spot regardless, but yeah, I think we're in Camp Lee's territory if we get to kill the Fiora.
Nothing escapes my watch.
And we have open attacks here, so Crescent Strike won't be good enough to save them again next turn. Should be good to go here. The shark coming back to you, right? You're probably not mulliganing aggressively enough if you're getting hosed with this deck. And I got a mulligan for Lucians and, Lucians and Plazas. Hi, KSO and Lillian, thanks for the follows, good morning. I like this build a lot. Pretty happy with this configuration. If you haven't seen this build of Plaza Ephemerals before, means you haven't checked out my website before. It's a great place for Runeterra deck lists. Not only do I keep a list of hand-curated lists up there, but there's also videos of me playing each of them. So if you see a deck list that looks neat, you can watch a short 20 to 30 minute highlight about it. Talks about how the deck works and see it play out in action before investing your resources into it. Huh, is Plaza fast enough against the bird deck? Honestly, not sure that it is. I think I'm gonna mulligan the Sharp Chariot, looking for some other cheaper things to play out ahead of time. But yeah, I mean, beggars shan't be choosers, I suppose. This is definitely not the type of hand we want in this matchup. Okay, that's not terrible. Means our turn four should be reasonable. This gets to block here at least, which is nice. If my opponent develops before attacking next turn, maybe we play this as a blocker? The reason for no star shaping in the Sunny Dragons deck. Yeah, that card's... The Sunny Dragons deck is an aggro deck. It's like a mid-range deck with an aggressive slant. And that card is very controlling. So I think that card is the wrong role that deck would like to be taking in most matches. Okay, so we're going to 14 here, and there's 10 caps in our deck, so we're probably at like 12 to 13, all things considered here. Fibruga, thanks for the follow. I actually think, Precipic, that the build that I'm playing here is better against this than a lot of the bigger Lucian Hecarim builds. I think Ravenous Butcher and Pesky and Cursed Keeper give us a lot of play in this matchup that the bigger builds playing Rekindler and stuff don't have. Obviously, we don't have most of those cards in this draw, so it feels a little bit bad at the moment, but I think in general, I'm not super worried about what this matchup is doing. We're also attacking on evens this game, which is a pretty big drawback in this matchup. Fibruga and Keen, thanks for the follows, welcome. Plaza likes attacking that even. That's less true in this build though, Precipic. So again, one of the reasons why I like this deck and I think it's more powerful is it has all of these zero cost things in addition to its ephemeral producers to make when you're attacking a lot less relevant. Some of the card choices we have in here explicitly serve to minimize some of those drawbacks you typically see in this archetype. Yeah, and like, you know, this is a pretty exceptionally low roll hand, all things considered, right? We've got like double Hecarim, triple Plaza. And who knows, maybe this into Hecarim is going to be enough here, we'll see. I mean, like, their burn happening there to my unit instead of my face is, like, dealing damage in the long term because it keeps Draven alive. Yeah, I mean, I actually think Swim had a really good game theory video the other day talking about landmarks and Plaza and, like, Targon's Peak in general. And I really loved that he hammered on... Just because a card doesn't have the word random in it, doesn't mean it's not a variant-powered card. I think that's something we see in card games too frequently. Like, for example, I actually think as a game, Hearthstone has less variants than Magic the Gathering, even though Hearthstone staples the word random onto a bunch of their cards. I think that's a pretty big misconception that just because the word random is attached to your cards, it means they're automatically have more variants than things that don't. People have a hard time evaluating things that contain variants that don't explicitly have variants in them. Oh, I can do this, can't I? Yeah, that's a good idea. Let's just clean the board out. Good call. Look at that. We were talking and chat saved me. Look at that big brain twitch advantage.
Floaty crystals.
What if I do this, actually? I probably need to kill this, right? Killing this part is optional.
Death doesn't scare me. Try
Honestly, across all card games, Swims probably has some of the best game theory of people that produce card game content on Twitch. He's very good at what he does. Kiro and Wirt, thanks for the follows. Good morning. We're going to six here. Six is a scary number. We're at a virtual five from this, and we could hit a puff cap here. One in three cards is going to have a puff cap, so we could realistically be dead to a decimate at this point. I have a link to Swim video. Just search Swim Stream on YouTube. It's its latest post. So we're technically not dead to known information, but we're dead to a stiff breeze. I'd also like to point out again that, like, this game, we drew Triple Plaza, we drew a bunch of Hecarims that were clunky, and, like, we're still one turn off of being able to kill them here, right? So, like, this game's incredibly close, and our draw was far from ideal here. And again, like, those details are, like, why when you're working with small sample sizes, you don't want to put a ton of weight into them, right? Like, that game was close. We were attacking on evens. We had a clunky draw, and it was still felt reasonable. Like, this hand sounds great. Glimpse is probably worth keeping here. Honestly, I think we're just keeping all of these. We get to Cursed Keeper on two, Plaza on three, Butcher Cursed Keeper attack for nine on three. If we hook the barrel instead of the Draven, we end up in the same spot, Senza. We get to play this on turn three now, too. I've liked Pesky Spectre a lot. Pesky Spectre makes your turn threes on the play with this super reasonable. It also gives you a cheap card to trigger Lucian as well as bring back sharks. The question is, do I want to kill this or do I want to leave it around? Do I give up 3 points of damage to kill this? I think I do. It kind of sucks that they have single combat. If they single combat, they get to trade these here. Sharpsight and Pale Cascade are both fine. Those are tricks they're going to have to use at some point. Like, even this here, right? Like, this Hush getting used, I got a 2-for-1 out of that, right? Like, that was fine. Like, I know it's, like, doesn't feel good to, like, not have combat go exactly how you wanted it to go, but, like, all things considered, when you think about the exchange that happened there, it was, like, whatever. Shining gifts from the sky. Radiant. Get to do this to deny them their life gain here, which is nice. So I have 8 mana this turn, which means I can play this Haunted Relic and then I can double Remembrance post-combat. This is another card that a lot of people haven't been playing in this archetype that I think is very, very good pretty consistently. Today. GTX, thanks for the follow. I've listened to plenty of Taylor Swift stuff, Tailrand. And she uses her platform to advocate for good politics, so I enjoy people who do that. She is responsible for getting lots of people to register to vote. Ariana, thanks for the follow. Welcome to the channel.
Her light is our sword, her warmth our armor.
Are we playing Lucian out so he can see things die in combat? Or are we playing Hecarim to have open attacks? I think we're doing this so we can see things die. Crack! Thanks for the follow. Welcome to the channel. I suppose I could technically do this and then pump it. I think I'd rather just trade here. Do you believe, chat? Do you believe?
Soldiers, to me.
Yes. Easy game. Easy game. What an incredibly skill-based game we play. Leona, and this is, you know, this is the reason to have played Hecarim last turn. Getting stunned here off of this is a big deal. I don't have enough mana to sharp sight. No pale, no sharp sight is great there for us. I think I want to take that opportunity to try and get that in. Them getting multiple stuns per turn off of this is pretty scary. Hopefully this Lucian Rally will be able to get us next turn. If you didn't know any better, I would suspect you're being sarcastic, Jeff. Well, you see, when a play works out in my favor, it was skillful. When a play works out in favor of my opponent, it was just variance.
Sunlight guide you, my brethren. Sunlight blinds.
That cursed keeper to start, see what they do.
War is everlasting.
I will shield my people as long as I draw breath.
So, Lucian's dead this turn. Even with the sharp sight, they're going to kill him with the challenger. So the question is, do I want to rally here? I think the answer is yes, right? I think I'd rather rally than have this turn back into a Lucian so we can, like, attack and then open attacks next turn. Really? Okay. Yeah, sure. Sure. Neolorino. They could have a sharp sight or a pale cascade of their own here. They didn't last turn, though. I'm probably not supposed to attack with this. I guess if they block, that's only at 1 out of 4, right?
Time marches on without you.
No mercy for heretics.
I could have hooked Leona here and then attacked with Lucien. Yeah, that's probably better. I don't think it matters, right? Because we're going to get to play Butcher to Rally here. Yeah, they're dead. I need Butcher for lethal, though. Any unit that we could play there would have done, though. You're correct. And again, really just highlighting the aggressive angle of this plaza build. Rather than going bigger with things like rekindlers and scout cards and trying to outgrind this greedy Demacia Targon deck, I can instead just kill them. Yeah, look at that card advantage. We killed our opponent with 5 cards in their hand. That attack was a 5-for-1. Attacking on odds kind of sucks here. Or attacking on evens kind of sucks, sorry. I'm going to mulligan these. I'm going to keep Cursed Keeper in case we find a cheap way to pop him. If we don't find a Butcher, I'm probably going to wait in Remembrance. On 3. Tickleson, thanks for the follow. Good morning. Good afternoon. It's almost 1 o'clock now. Gosh, the time flies when I'm playing RuneTerra. This game's great. Howdy, CJD, and Azamum. Perfect. Just like we drew it up. We have guests. And then, actually here, I'm going to go ahead and pass. Because if these die in combat this turn, I get to Remembrance and possibly get a turn 3 Radiant Guardian, which should just be game over if it happens. So there's no way they're not attacking, and if they're not attacking, that's good for us, so easy pass back here. So, that trade's not amazing, but again, taking it so I can Remembrance here. So we're 20% to get a Radiant Guardian on this. There's 5 different things that this can generate. Scout Attacker sounds great too. The moose is loose, chat. The moose is loose. Fatty's Revenge, thanks for the follow. So, I think with that, we just go ahead and play Fog here. Do you think Zoe is broken? No. Zoe's just a good card. I feel like so many people are convinced that, like, things either have to be broken or unplayable. It's just like a fine card. How greedy is it to glimpse here? Probably greedy. I think I just take the pass, right? I don't think that's specific to Magic Digits. I think people thinking cards are either busted or unplayable is pretty normal. I think Zoe's actually a great example of a card that's just, like, good without being overbearing. Yeah, I agree. I think there's very little in the game currently that I would change in terms of nerfs. So, how do we feel about Glimpse this, play Radiant Guardian, kill Jack? Can I lose if I do that? I think that's pretty close to can't lose territory, right? Or I personally change. I would make pack your bags more expensive.
No one's the wiser.
I fight for the fallen. Banish the unworthy.
Don't mind me. Just killing your best card. Going back to 20. So if I sharp sight this, it goes up to 8, and then it takes 4 and 2, so it lives. Swing low, Shark Chariot. Come along to carry me home.
Looking for trouble? It found you.
The moose is loose, chat. We have guests.
Who's ready for a show?
Kero Haven and Pimp Pimp, thanks for the follows. Captain Pharaon to draw to at this point, they could get back in this game. But they're already through two Jack the Winner, so like our average card quality is definitely a little bit better than theirs from here on out. And we have a lethal attacker with Scout, so. Planara, thanks for the follow. Good morning. And hey, we had a shark die earlier, so this is gonna bring back a shark next turn, so even that's fine. Gangplank's pretty good. Honestly, I think the second plaza's the play here, right? Because the second plaza means that the shark comes back as a 5 attacker. Mr. Piccolini, thanks for the follow. Good morning. Waiting to play this so it can bring back the shark next turn.
The chains, they never stop.
They never stop. They're dead, right? These hook these. This brings back shark. I have 2 lethal attackers and they have 1 blocker. Really tight, close game. Oh, sweet. Yeah, like I said at a couple points throughout the set, This deck is mostly... this deck is mostly three ofs at this point. Like, two Warden's Prey is split with two Radiant Guardian is the only non-three ofs. In general, I personally prefer this configuration of the Lucian Plaza deck to the go bigger builds that are playing Rekindler and Scout. I think this aggressive build with Curse Keeper and Blighted Caretaker and Ravenous Butcher really gives you good tools to play into when you don't have the Plaza. The other builds have been very lackluster when they don't have their key card. Hey, thanks for the tip, Ellie Chan. I'll get that deck added to the queue after I'm done streaming today. All right, so we're done with this deck, but don't go anywhere because we're far from done.